Welcome to the Black Entrepreneur Experience Podcast, inside the business, buzz, and brilliance of Black entrepreneurs. Here is your host, Dr. Frances Richards.
What happens in Vegas goes all over the world on the Black Entrepreneur Experience bonus episode. Thank you for joining us for Black Entrepreneur Experience. This is where we shine the light on the most successful Black entrepreneurs in the world. I'm your host, Dr. Frances Richards. I am so humbly honored to have with us today John Ballantine. He's the founder of Toadlane.com, but his previous experience, he founded BevPost, an interactive mobile coupon distribution company in Minnesota. Thank you, John, for joining us on Black Entrepreneur Experience.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
You know what? I have given our audience a very brief snippet about you and your company. Why don't you fill in the gaps and share with us what you'd like us to know about yourself and your company?
Sure. Toadlane, it's a B2B purchasing and sourcing platform. And what that means is people that like wholesaling and building markets and selling and high volumes, we make it easy for people to get started because there's a lot of people that don't know how to even become a wholesaler and start selling things in large volume. So we help people that have the interest and the drive to get started from no money, square one, to building their volume to millions of dollars. And, you know, we're seeing the success of our clients. So it's really exciting.
So, John, tell our audience, how did you come up with this idea? What was that aha moment that you knew that Toadlane was going to be successful?
When I started it versus when I knew Toadlane was going to be successful, I don't know if those are two different things. I started it because when my company that you mentioned, BevPost, when that went down, I launched another. I've been an entrepreneur since I was like 11 years old. So this is something I've been blessed with the ability to work. And that's one thing I've always had. So I've always taken that as sacred, my ability to work and create opportunities. So with BevPost, after that, I launched a beef jerky company in Minnesota that was quite successful. And the business partnership didn't really work out the way that we wanted it to. So it kind of broke my heart. But before it fully broke my heart, I wanted to launch another company. So I launched a company that was focused on iPhone cases and cell phone cases because I figured that was a very, very hot thing. And so I started using Amazon's fulfillment distribution lines. And what that basically means is that you buy a bunch of iPhone cases, you send them to fulfillment by Amazon. So you send it to their warehouses and they let their customers buy it from you, you know, buy your inventory. So I was really excited about that. But the thing that I saw was that from the cost of the inventory, from the amount of money that you make, from the fees that Amazon charges to use their program, I got so frustrated that I had this vision from God on what I needed to do and where I needed to be and this purpose of empowering entrepreneurship and making entrepreneurship easier for everyone and just lowering the barriers in general. And when that vision hit me, I let it manifest, for a couple of days. And then I hopped in a car, you know, with a couple of sketches on a piece of paper and just decided to move to California because I needed a bigger market in order to implement the vision that was in my head. And so I guess, to be perfectly honest with you, I'm a very spiritual person. So as soon as I got hit with that vision, I knew that I was going to be successful with it. To be completely honest with you, I never had a doubt in my mind. When you have a really spiritual vision that hits you and tells you where you need to be, if you really believe in yourself and you really believe in your purpose and what you're trying to do and if it's going to benefit people, then I would suggest when you have those moments that you listen to the universe and you execute, because it's no longer about the idea. It's about how much you really believe in what you're doing. And if you do believe in what you're doing, then you should be doing it, right? So that's the reason why I hopped in a car with no money, drove to California and started working and seeing the fruits of my labor 5.5 years later, but I'm very grateful and very excited for that. But yeah, so I guess I knew I was going to be successful as soon as I had that vision because I'm all about execution.
John, tell our audience, when you said you hopped in the car, drove to LA with no money, how did you sustain yourself in LA without any money and working on this project?
Well, okay. So I didn't have any money at the time, but to be honest with you, I had a job in Minnesota where I was the number one ranked salesperson in T-Mobile statewide. And so I transferred my job from Minnesota to California. So I didn't have any money at the time, but I definitely had a job lined up when I first came down here, because it's not that easy to just do anything, but that's what I did. And you know, the thing with my sales job is that I've always had the ability to sell. And my belief is that if you have any type of job, that you should be the best at it, and you should strive to be the best person at it. So I transferred the job, hopped in the car, and, you know, moved out here. It's, you know, I kept it as simple as possible. Funny story, though. This is a really funny story. So when I say no money, I meant like $100, but like I ran out of money on the way over here. When I was driving through Utah, I had a Saab. So I literally ran out of gas, right, in Utah, right? No money to get to California. So what I did, because it's a very mountainous terrain, I put my car into neutral and I floated down the mountains, because I figured if I could float all the way to Vegas, that I could use my Geico car insurance to get towed to the nearest city, which was Las Vegas. And then I was able to beg for some money from my parents, my godparents, to hop on a Greyhound and make it there. So I barely made it to California, but definitely, definitely did.
Well, that's a wonderful story. So thanks for sharing that. How would you define John today? How do you define success?
For me today, success is making other people being successful, other people making money, the joy in someone's voice when they've made a lot of money or had a transaction through Toadlane, or when they have a job. And for example, there's an entrepreneur in Texas, and Jason Brooks is his name. I don't think he'll mind me saying his name. This guy is currently a security guard in Texas. Like, he has a job right now. He's been watching. He was one of the first people to sign up on the site a couple of years ago. He's been watching us continuously improve, continuously reinvest their money, improve. And the first computers that he listed, because, you know, we're a wholesale site, so we have a lot of B2B businesses. So the first items that he listed, he had a company with $18 billion of assets interested in buying up all his stock. So that's an $18,000 sale that he got in his first listing, and now he can build and grow off of that. Because usually when you do like a $5,000 to $20,000 sale or $40,000, those are usually test orders to scale up your money. Because if you make a purchase like that, you're going to make a certain amount of margin as a wholesaler, and that extra money that you make, if you reinvest it, you can build $18,000 to like $100,000 to $500,000 if you're consistent with buying it, reinvesting back into your product and growing your inventory. It's really easy, you know. So for this guy literally just has a buyer through Toadlane that is going to make it easy for him to quit his job like next week. And that was him having a job, being apprehensive, but coming to the market with incredible pricing and having an opportunity like immediately. So I'm just terrible. So congratulations to Jason, but that is really how I define success. I had another customer today that had, you know, $13,000 wired into his bank account for a test order through a buyer of mine, or of Toadlane's, that I've known for years and years and years. And after this $13,000 transaction, assuming that the seller fills the order as quickly as possible, this buyer is prepared to buy $250,000 a day of his stuff. So it's just like one of those things where when I hear customer success stories through the platform, it just makes me incredibly excited and happy, and motivates me to work even harder, to take care of everyone, to keep on going, to build out our infrastructure, to continuously improve and all that good stuff.
And how long did it take for success to manifest in Toadlane?
Well, I'll tell you, I think that it's a little deceptive to think that you just hit a certain point and you have success, you know, because if you think about it, what is success? Success is really what you define it, right? Is it when we make a lot of money? Is that what success is? Or is it like customers being happy? Like, I know this girl that was in college with me. I won't name her name or anything like that, but we're both entrepreneurs, and I really liked her, had a crush on her. and she was out in California. I moved out to California. She helped, helped the company raise $100 million, and then she quit the company and she's going to work for Google or Facebook or whatever, which is awesome for her. I'm really happy and excited for her. But in terms of personal fulfillment, personal enjoyment, I'm much more satisfied with the path that I personally took, because I built something completely from scratch, instead of. So I think that success is very tricky like that. And I think that also, even when you're making $500,000 a year or $1 million a year or whatever, you have overhead and you constantly have bills. And no matter what, the more money we make, the more bills that we have, right? Like, even if we sold $1 trillion worth of items in Toadlane, when we hit that point, it's like, I don't even know if I consider that success, because we still got bills. Success is really based on the customer experience and customers having a wonderful and happy experience and continually using you and supporting you. That's what I consider success. When you have hardcore customers that love your service, that need your service, that want you around, and that attribute wealth that they have in their life to you and want to continue using your platform because it helps fulfill and empower their life, that's what I consider success.
John, share with our audience, what is a daily or weekly habit that you do consistently that has given you the greatest success?
The number one thing that I do is I control my vibration. I'll explain this a little bit. So 3 years ago, I had brain surgery. I had a seizure and I had brain surgery and I had a little bit of my brain taken out. Prior to that, we had an alpha version of the site, right? And the alpha version of the site, and I kid you not, and I wish I was exaggerating, we screwed up. So this is attempted transactions, right? People going crazy and trying to do attempted transactions of $1.5 billion, right? Or 1.6 or something like that. We had successful transactions during that time, but it was like 2 years, $1.6 billion of transactions that we couldn't process. And to put that in perspective, when you do like a PayPal transaction, you send someone $100, that's not a big deal, right? Now, try sending someone $50,000 through PayPal and see what happens. They're going to shut your account down or they're going to freeze that money. That affects transactions. It makes things very tough. So that was the thing that we really had to deal with. And it just made things really, really difficult. So yeah, I'm actually banned for life from PayPal and Stripe, believe it or not, because the wholesale industry, the markets that we're in, I mean, I had an underwriter explain this to me after the fact. They told me that I am considered higher risk than like a porn site because the amount of transactions that people are trying to do, like they're not trying to do $5 transactions. There's a lot of wholesalers that want to do $100,000 transactions or $500,000 transactions or $1 million. I mean, that's pretty common. Millions of dollars in purchasing is very common in wholesale industries, and even bigger than that. And the thing is that there really, aside from a bank wire up front, there really aren't, many standardized ways of dealing with this. So that's where this whole problem emerged. And I was literally in this apartment trying to close these massive, huge deals to pay my rent, to pay my bills. And you almost feel like a pathological liar after a while when you have multi-million dollar transactions that you can't close because you have, I've had at least 10 different bank processors turn us down. So after I had brain surgery, okay, I went up into the woods and I studied a lot of, and so I had like an open mind, completely open mind. I knew that I couldn't be doing physical labor. I had to figure out a way to work from my couch. And I studied a lot of things. And one of the biggest things that I studied that really changed my life was this philosopher named Hermes Trismegistus, I believe. And he was an ancient Egyptian philosopher. It's rumored that, Jesus studied at his school around like 30 or something like that. And he teaches these universal laws, right? And the universal laws, these principles, for example, everything vibrates, right? Like, for example, like if you were to look at a spectrum, which is another universal principle, but like everything vibrates. So like the lowest form of vibration, for example, would be like a rock, right? And like the highest form of vibration would be like spirit, right? Like if we were to just put it on a spectrum, that makes sense, right? Like a rock being the lowest because it's just still, and then spirit being the highest form of vibration, right?
Right.
So what that concept, though, just in itself, that A, there's a spectrum, but there's a vibration, and that you have the ability to control your vibration on a daily basis, that blew my mind. And the reason why is because what that means is that every day we have the opportunity to define where and what our vibration is and what we want it to be. And that determines how the universe is going to respond to us. So that doesn't necessarily mean that I'm going to say that my vibration is going to be, you know, this thing, and I'm just going to get it immediately, even though I'm sure that I could if I was that good at it. But in general, as you know, so I wake up every day and I look in the mirror and I make my mirror vows to the face, just like Drake says, you know, like mirror vows to the face. They're like I do that every single day and every single night. And I have my own, you know, vows to my face that I remind myself of. I used to just write a list, and I still do the list thing. Richard Branson talks about that. Big fan of lists. But I think that just waking up every day and reminding myself of my purpose, what I want to accomplish, and then going to sleep saying the same thing. Because what that does is throughout the day, you're going to have a million distractions. I mean, some people even watch television, which I think is crazy. But in general, like, there's all types of distractions. There's, you know, there's constantly radio or television or whatever, just pushing for your attention, pushing for your mind space, trying to distract you, trying to segment you, trying to, you know, let you know what you are, categorize you, and tell you how you're supposed to feel based on this, you know. And that's all a distraction, right? Those are all things that are designed to tell you what your vibration is. But when you know what your vibration is, then the universe says, aha, okay, so this person knows what they are, what their vibration is, and then the universe responds in kind to your vibration, to your attitude. So, for example, if my focus is on, you know, being, I don't necessarily want to talk about what my daily affirmations are, because those are my daily affirmations. I think it's important for people to not listen to this podcast and say, hey, I'm going to copy his affirmations. No, it's important for people to define what their own affirmations are and be real with them and stick to them, right? But that in itself, just knowing who you are and reminding yourself and sticking to that, that defines your attitude, right? Like, let's just look at the polarity of this for a second, or the spectrum of this. So, like, if I was like a gangbanger, right, and I was like in the Blood or the Crips or something like that, and I had tattoos on my face, and every day I'd look in the mirror and I'd see those gang tattoos on my face, that's a reaffirmation that I'm a gangbanger, right? And that's a reaffirmation to everybody around me, to anybody that interacts at me, to anybody that looks at me, that I'm a gangbanger. So then anyone that sees me is going to respond in kind to, hey, this person is outwardly pushing this perception of this person as a gangbanger, right? So on the opposite spectrum, I am who I am. So you'd have to imagine that, especially with someone being as conscious and aware as I am, that, you know, if anyone, you know, I attract billionaires, I attract people with businesses, I attract distribution companies, because I've defined my vibration and my affirmations in a way where those are the people that like talking to me, that feel comfortable talking to me. And that's how I know that I'm doing the right stuff, because I'm talking to the people I should be talking to, right? When I clear my mind and I'm in tune with my own vibration. And I notice that on the days where, you know, maybe I'm not driving my own car, or if I'm, you know, talking to the wrong girl or whatever, I allow myself to be distracted. Those are the days that I'm least productive, don't get nearly as much done, and don't see the success that I have. To be completely frank with you, I have expectations for success now, you know? Like, it's not like every day. No, it's like I need it now all the time. You know what I mean? And that's just my level of intensity. But I think that just in general, knowing who you are, knowing that even if you are not doing the affirmations and you're not aware of your vibration, then that's what your vibration is. It's not doing those affirmations and not being aware of those vibrations. And that might land a person in the majority of the people. And then they have to ask themselves, especially if they're listening to a podcast like this and come across it, you know, why am I listening to this podcast? Why is this resonating with me so hard? And maybe I should take that a little bit more seriously and do those affirmations and do those vibrations and pay, maybe look up Hermes because that's what I did. And that has made all the difference for me.
Let me ask you this, and I don't know if you would say the same thing. If in reference to what is one book you would recommend to the audience and why?
Blue Ocean Strategies. Blue Ocean Strategies is the best book I've ever read in my entire life. Now, I'll tell you though, I came from a broken family, but I would never want anybody to feel bad for me because my father has a graduate degree from Harvard and my mother went to Harvard and they met at Harvard and my grandma from both sides both graduated from Harvard. My grandparents and my grandfather has his own iTunes channel. You know, so we have a long history of success in both ends, but from the immediate standpoint, I'm actually grateful for this looking back, to be honest with you, because, you know, my father was as successful as, you know, my expectation for him would be, then I'd never have the universal ability to bounce back. I believe in this idea of like corrections where things go down and then they bounce back up, you know, they respond in kind. And I would have never had this opportunity or this drive to be successful had that not happened. But Blue Ocean Strategies is one of the best books I ever read in my entire life, because what it teaches entrepreneurs to do is not look at what's hot, to look at what people are not looking at. So that book literally blew my mind. That was the most important book. And the second most important book I read was probably the autobiography of Warren Buffett. I read that when I was like 15 or 16 years old. That was so basically, and my grandma actually worked for the White House, by the way, and she worked for the FCC and got Robert Johnson of BET the funding to get his company off the ground. So like literally don't ever feel bad for me. One of the things that she did though, so I left Boston, broken family, went to Northern Virginia with my grandmother, very powerful woman, powerful personality. We did not get along. I was running away. So my godfather, Ed Cohen, who lived like a couple blocks down, who happened to be like the number one ranked central learning officer in the world at the time. So just like one of the best people you could possibly ask for growth and development, right? I was trying to just figure out who I wanted to be. And I read about Warren Buffett. And I love Warren Buffett. Like, I really liked his personality. I liked who he was. And I was like, okay, this guy is like a billionaire. I think he was like number one at a certain point. And I was like, well, you know, I want to be number one. So I just studied everything that he knew. So I not only studied Warren Buffett, but I studied everybody that Warren Buffett studied. And then I read all his shareholder reports. So this is at like, you know, 14, 15 years old. So I knew everything about Warren Buffett. And actually, I wrote Warren Buffett a letter. And his secretary wrote me one back and said that Warren Buffett read my letter and really liked it and all that stuff. But I was obsessed with all those guys growing up, just learning about, you know, just wanting to know what they know and getting in tune with their vibration, basically. So Blue Ocean Strategies, but really just kind of obsessing about people that have been incredibly successful and figuring out what they do right and benchmarking that and making progress that way.
So, John, what is one valuable lesson you wish you knew before starting your business?
That's a really good question. I think that in general, it's important to embrace the mistakes that you make and listen and figure out why you made those mistakes. If anything, the one thing that I feel like I should have done more, especially up front, was invested more into myself. Like, I remember one of my earlier business partners suggested that we not release a feature because it was going to be too hard and take like 2 years to get done. And so he's like, we just can't do it right now. So I just, you know, trusted him, assumed that he was smart and everything like that, but he's not around and I am. And I put 6 months into releasing this feature and it's the most successful thing that we have. So I guess that only mistakes that I truly regret were not fully doing exactly what I wanted to do and being as ambitious as I wanted to be up front. Because even if you fail at that, the goal is to learn from your failures and improve and just look at it as a part of the path of success. So listening to other people, shooting down my dreams was probably the biggest mistake that I've made. It's cost me time. Definitely.
What is a technology tool or a technology platform that is a must-have for you in managing your business?
The thing that has really, really, really helped me a lot are project management systems. Efficient project management systems that allow us to track every single task, every single idea that pops up in my head, because an idea is only as good as the execution of it. We have a custom-made one but there's all types of project management, free project management tools out there. And I would suggest anybody building anything that's worth building, use collaborative tools with their team.
Okay. And so let me ask you this, John, if you conducted this interview, what is the one question that you wish I would have asked you? And I would like you to ask the question and also answer the question.
Oh, wow. Okay. What is my ultimate goal with Toadlane? And where do we see ourselves in 10 years? And my answer for that would be empowering entrepreneurs around the world and making it easier for people, especially in areas in the country where they might not have access to certain things except relationships, and especially in different parts of the world, just making it easier for them to connect and facilitate their relationships. And if we can do that on a global scale and get a certain percentage of the global economy, I'll be quite satisfied with that.
So why don't you share with our audience a parting piece of advice you want to offer?
The parting piece of advice that I would offer is to follow your dreams and follow your purpose no matter what. And never to put money ahead of purpose or dreams, because I've seen so many people not follow through on their dreams in pursuit of a steady income, or especially a steady income, or for the so-called safe route. And that in itself is really an illusion, the idea that there's things that are safe. And there's nothing more dangerous than a company fostering you to be dependent on them and not learn how to make your own income.
Tell us this. What have you not done in life that you dream about often?
Love to have a family, a happy family. My godfather, when I lived in India for a couple of years. And when I lived in India, they built 250,000 square foot building for my godfather when he was down there, because he was doing, it wasn't just for him, obviously, it was to support his learning organization, because he really, really, really helped and develop and train tens of thousands of Indians in India, you know, getting involved in the tech sector and everything. And so that's always been a goal of mine, to build a castle in like Brazil, or maybe a couple castles. But not just to build them for other people, to facilitate community and empower people and all of that. But I really want to travel. I really want to build things. And traveling and building are the main things. I'd love to live in South America for a little while. I'd love to move to Africa for a little bit. I have family in the Caribbean. I've never been to Barbados before. So there's a lot of traveling that I have to do. But I figure, you know, get the dream part out of the way first. And then I'll have plenty of time to travel when I in like a year or two, with the laptop in front of me, of course, but, you know, still traveling.
Absolutely. That's the only way to do it. John, we've come to the part of our interview where it's called Fun Facts Lightning Round. I'm going to ask you a series of questions. And what I'd like you to do is give us very quick answers. And if there's something that you desire not to answer, feel free to say pass. You
okay.
ready?
Yep.
Okay. The last movie you saw?
Oh, geez. Pass.
You relax doing what?
I live in California, so smoking pot.
Your favorite singer or rapper?
Drake.
Your favorite dance song?
Oh, one song by Selena from like 15 years ago. I forget the name of it. Skinny song by Selena.
Okay. And what food you eat every week, no matter what?
Natural peanut butter. I know it sounds weird, but I wake up with pajamas on, and I usually stay in my pajamas for most of the day, because I wake up and work, and I usually work, you know, I work in my team probably 18 to 19 to 20, you know, I can work 18 hours a day. I'm a workaholic. So I just wake up, pajamas, and as long as I have natural peanut butter, I'm happy.
And your favorite month is?
November 22nd, or November.
Thank you for that. You know, John, we want to thank you for being on Black Entrepreneur Experience. But before we let you go, what is the best way for our audience to connect with you and to support your business?
Well, to connect with me, my email is johnb@toadlane.com. So anyone that sends me an email, I'll look at it no matter what. I might not respond to it, but I will 100% look at it, especially if they're interested in entrepreneurship and are looking for advice or how to get going or build their brands or build distribution. Those are all things that I'm always interested in and helping anybody out in. So please, I encourage people to send me an email there. Best way to help out would be to talk about Toadlane and spread it among their friends and say good things about us. You know, set up an account and see how we can work together. That would be the best way, really, is to set up an account and see how we can set up distribution channels together, because we're all about driving success for entrepreneurs.
Absolutely. John, we want to thank you for your time, and we appreciate you. And we want to give a shout out to Starbucks. And the other day we were at McDonald's, so we want to thank them. This is what we call an entrepreneur on the go. So we, if you heard background noises in this interview, we just want to be very transparent. John here is an entrepreneur on the go. And so we appreciate him giving us the time, because he's a very busy young man. So that's a wrap for us.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Dr. Francis, for your time. And I look forward to seeing, hearing this podcast and seeing and talking to you again.
Absolutely.
Thank you for listening and subscribing to Black Entrepreneur Experience. We would love for you to leave a review and rating on iTunes and share with your friends. For show notes and more episodes, go to www.beepodcast.com. Join us next Wednesday, and remember, green is the new black. So keep your bank accounts and your business in the black.